In chapter 23, we'll start looking at new kinds of reactions of carbonyl compounds. Up until now, all the reactions that we've been looking at are all reactions of a carbonyl compound with a nucleophile. The mechanism of this reaction was affected by whether or not our R group was a good leaving group or not. So all the reactions started the same way, with the nucleophile coming in, adding to the carbonyl, and the electron pair going out on oxygen. This happens because the nucleophile has electrons, and the carbonyl carbon of the carbonyl wants electrons. So we have our nucleophile and our electrophile. Now in chapter 23, what we'll start looking at is reactions where our carbonyl compound will react with an electrophile. So there's two different ways to do this. One is in a neutral or acidic method, and the other is through a basic chemistry. I'll start with a basic chemistry. And so if we have this molecule and we treat it with a strong base, we'll talk about later which kind of bases it will work. This base has to come and remove a proton. So the question that you need to ask first is, which is the most acidic proton in my molecule? And you have three protons to choose from. You have an aldehyde proton, you have a proton that's alpha to the carbonyl, and you have a proton that's beta to the carbonyl. You could also have other ones that are gamma or delta or further away from the carbonyl, but this is illustrative of the different types of protons that we can have and which one would be the most acidic and the easiest to pull off. So let's go through and take a look at what would happen if we pull off different protons. If I pull off this proton out here, this electron pair goes on to carbon, and it's isolated there because I have an sp3 carbon next to it before I get to the carbonyl. Okay, so here I get an isolated negative charge. Now if I pull off the aldehyde proton, I once again have an isolated negative charge, as there's nowhere for this electron pair to go. There's already a full octet around this oxygen, so I can't push another pair of electrons up towards that oxygen. So because of that, I have this isolated negative charge at the carbonyl carbon, which also would rather have a positive charge than a negative charge. So the last possibility, and I'll redraw it from the start just because the molecule is getting a little bit messy up there, is to pull off the proton alpha to the carbonyl, which then pushes this electron pair up here to form an alkene, and this pair onto oxygen. And what we get here is an enolate. Our charge is delocalized through here. We can have a negative charge at the alkene carbon end, or we can have the negative charge at the oxygen end. The best way to draw an enolate usually is with the charge on oxygen, because oxygen is more electronegative than carbon and would rather have the negative charge. However, as you will learn in this chapter, a lot of times it reacts more at this carbon end than it does at the oxygen end. We'll see examples of those. So once we've formed our enolate, now we can introduce the electrophile. Now there are two potential sites that the electrophile can add. One is the oxygen with the negative charge, the other is at the carbon with the negative charge. And as it turns out, these reactions typically will react. This electron pair will come back down to reform the carbonyl. This electron pair will come out to grab the electrophile. And what we get is addition of an electrophile at the alpha carbon. Now we can also draw that reaction in neutral solution. So if we have this aldehyde, we know that it can form keto-enol tautomers. So here's the enol version, and the ketone version typically is about 99% to about 1% of the enol version at normal equilibrium. So we have nearly all of this aldehyde in the aldehyde form. However, there's a very small amount of it that is in the enol form. And if it's in the enol form, it can react with the electrophile. Now this alkene here for the enol is a nucleophile, just like other alkenes that we've seen, and this pair of electrons can come out and grab the electrophile to make an intermediate. And once we have the intermediate, we can have something come along to deprotonate to get rid of our positive charge. And the most acidic proton is this OH proton up here. So if I have something come along, it doesn't have to be really basic, it'd be something like water even, can come by, grab this proton, This electron pair goes back to form the carbonyl, and we get the same product that we did last time using the enolate, this time through a neutral enol. So far we've seen simple carbonyls where the equilibrium greatly favors the keto form, but what happens if we have a beta dicarbonyl? So in a beta dicarbonyl, if we form the enol on one side, what actually can happen is we can get hydrogen bonding between the carbonyl and the enol. And with that hydrogen bonding, becomes more stability. So in the case of a beta dicarbonyl, it's about 76% enol, while only 24% keto. So the equilibrium is shifted from back here with this aldehyde, which is nearly 99% or maybe even greater than 99% aldehyde, and 1% or even less than 1% enol.